76. ओके सो द स्क्रीन इज विजिबल, एनीवन कैन वॉच.
यस सर.
ओके सो टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द अनदर चैप्टर, द न्यू चैप्टर व्हिच डील्स विद अगेन ऑन द सिमिलर ग्राउंड्स ऑफ व्हाट वी लर्नड इन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर, दैट इज द लिस्ट डेटा टाइप एंड लिस्ट लाइक डेटा टाइप्स, राइट, वेयर इन वी लर्नड अबाउट द कंप्लीट स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ लिस्ट एज वेल एज व्हाट आर द डिफरेंट टाइप्स ऑफ लिस्ट लाइक डेटा टाइप्स, दैट इज strings and as well as tuples, right? So in today's lecture we will have another data type which is similar to it, not actually a list but a data type which almost performs like a list, right? So it is like you can see there, yeah? It's the dictionary data type. So after learning this word dictionary, a few things can come to your mind, that dictionary data types means meaning, or the word which has a meaning, something like that, is stored in the list or some kind of structure, right? So as the name suggests, it is exactly like that. It has a few set of words, right? They can be the keywords, and it has the meaning of it, so we can call a value of it. So basically dictionary is actually a set of key and value pair. So as you can see here, that it's a collection of many values. Dictionary has, as we know, dictionary has set of all the words, right, different types of words. So dictionary data type also, it has different types of different collections of many values, right? But unlike the indexes or the indexes that we have learned in the list, the indexes in the dictionary can be of any data type. If you can recall, in the list we understood that the index can be referred with the integer value, integer numbers, right? So for example, spam of 0 or spam of 1, something like that. But unlike those indexes, in the dictionary data type we can have even with the words as our indexes, or the keywords or characters in case of our indexes, right? So that is the difference when we talk about the list data type and the dictionary data type. In dictionary we can have different words which can be our indexes. So indexes for dictionaries can use many different data types, not just integer, like I said. So indexes are indexes for dictionaries are called keys. So here you can see this is an example of a dictionary data type, wherein we have, if you can see, there is a key here and subsequently there is a value for it separated by a comma. So this whole thing is a key value pair. So the dictionary is set of such key values, key value pairs, right? So every key here, for example size, is associated with some kind of value, some value. So size here, as you can see, fat, then the key color has the value gray, and the key disposition has the value loud. So you can see that every key has a appropriate value to it. So the dictionary is a collection of key value pairs, right? So this is the easy identification of how a color, how a list data type is different from different other data types like string or tuple or list. Now another important point to be noticed here is you can see the curly braces here, right? So in case of list we used square brackets, in case of string we only used the single quote, and in case of tuples we made use of parentheses, right? So whenever you see such kind of representation with a curly brace, then you can say that it is a particularly a dictionary data type, right? So this my cat here, let's say I have a variable which is let's say I have a dictionary called my cat, and it has these many key value pairs in it, right? So inside a curly brace separated by commas we have the key value pairs. Now when I talk about the indexes here, as I mentioned, the indexes in case of dictionary data type need not be just numbers that we have, like in case of our list data type. We had numbers or integers to represent a particular index. But unlike that, in dictionary, we can have the words or the key themselves as our indexes. So in my dictionary, let's say my cat, if I want to retrieve a value, some value, I can simply pass the key value, key to the index, key as the index for my dictionary. So my dictionary, my cat, as you can see here, I'm passing the value here, not a number, right? So it's not like my cat of zero, like we used to write in lists. But instead of that, what I'm doing is I'm writing the key itself. So my cat, and then in square brackets, size. So that will eventually return me the value for that particular index, which has the key named size. Okay. So this is a simple example. You can see that this is a string that I want to print, a statement that I want to print, but I'm making use of the index here, which is a word and not a number. So my cat has dash fur, fine. And in that dash, what I'm going to fill is I'm going to just retrieve the value by giving the parameter as key itself, my cat color, and then it will automatically retrieve the value assigned to the color. For example, here the color is gray, so the key value is gray here. This is the key, this is the value. So it's simple, I think, to understand, right? But they do not have to start from zero, like in case of our list, right? The indexes need not to start from zero itself. If you can recall all our previous examples, whatever we have seen, in almost all the cases, we have started with the index zero or maybe sometimes index one, right? But unlike those data types, that is tuple data type or list data type, in case of dictionary data type, we can start the indexes from wherever we want, right? It gives us the liberty to select a particular index from wherever you want. So there is no particular start point. You can define your own start point, right? And on top of it, it need not be just a number. It can be, again, like I said, can be a word also. So here is a simple example. Let's say I have a dictionary called spam, and inside this dictionary, I have two key value pairs. These are the two key values. This is first key value pair separated by a comma. I have another key value pair. The first key is 12345, which has the value luggage combination. Okay, this is just a value. Don't worry about this. What is this luggage combination? It's a simple value or a meaning or a word assigned to a key. Alright, so 12345, and then the value is luggage combination. And then the second key in my dictionary spam is 42, right, which has the value the answer. So just don't worry about these answers or whatever that I'm putting into the single string, single quote. But the main important point to be focused here is there is not necessarily the index has to be start from zero or something like that. There's no rule that it has to be start from zero only, like in case of a list or when you talk about arrays also, we usually start from the index zero, right? So that is not the case in dictionaries. So having learned about this, what is dictionary? Now, what is the difference between this dictionary and list? Let us compare these two. Let us have an understanding, take an example let us take an example which can define us what is the difference between a dictionary as well as a list. Okay, so let us first understand what we have already done, right? We have already came across these statements wherein we have operated with our lists, right? So let's say I have a list spam is equal to this, which if you can recall, we have already taken this as an example. Spam is equal to cats, dogs, and moose. And I have another list, let's say bacon is equal to dogs, moose, and cats. So though these two may look same, but when you compare this two lists, that is spam is double equal to bacon, it will return false. The reason is because the list is getting compared exactly with the zeroth index with the zeroth index of the spam, zeroth index of the bacon with the zeroth index of the spam, first index of the bacon with the first index of the spam, and so on, right? So the comparison is made index to index. So when the index zero is not matching with the index zero in spam, right? The index zero in bacon is not matching with the index zero in spam, it will return a false value that the both the list are not exactly the same. But in case of dictionaries, when we, let's say I gave a dictionary name called X, which consists of few key and value pairs. Key, let's say I have three keys, that is name, species, and age, with the values Zofi, cat, and 8 respectively. Okay, so name is Zofi, species is cat, and age is 8. This is my first dictionary. In my second dictionary, I give the same key values, but not in the same order, right? The indexes are not same now. So my new dictionary name is ham, and I have just shuffled the key value pair, but I have kept the values and the keys same, right? So species is cat itself, the age is 8 itself, and the name is the same, Zofi, right? Now when I compare the dictionary egg with the dictionary ham, you can see that it is returning me the value true. So you can easily spot the difference that the comparison what a dictionary makes and the comparison what list makes is different, right? List makes the comparison or compares the list on the basis of indexes, appropriate exact indexes. But in case of dictionary, the dictionary considers the whole dictionary and then checks or compares with the other dictionary whether it is same or not. It may not be necessary that the same key value pair is at the same index in the other dictionary. Not necessary, right? So this is the reason why, because the dictionaries are not ordered, right? You can clearly make it out that dictionaries are not ordered or not in sequence in compared to lists. Lists are more ordered or sequenced data type. If you can recall the definition of list when we first learned about what is a list, if you can recall, it is a ordered structure or a ordered or a sequence of values, right? List. But dictionary is not so. It is an unordered or not so ordered structure, you can say. But the dictionaries, they can be sliced, right? We learned the concept of slicing a particular list, right? Similarly, the dictionary can also be sliced. The dictionary can be sliced, sorry. Like lists, how we were able to slice a few set of indexes, let's say from zero index to fourth index. If you can recall the example which we have discussed, from zero index to four index, we were able to slice the items from the list. But in case of dictionary, we cannot slice those items. The reason is simple, because they are unordered, right? The dictionary is unstructured or unsequenced fashion. So even if you try to attempt it, you will probably get an error saying that there is a key error, right? So let's say the example spam, which has the key value pair name Zofi and age 7, right? And I'm trying to retrieve the value spam color. So it will just throw me the error that it is not in the list, right? So the value is missing, basically. The key value is missing here. So let's understand with an example, a full-fledged example, and understand a program, let's call it birthdays. And in this program birthdays, we are storing the birth date of few of our friends. Okay, so I am kind of creating a dictionary wherein I am saving the birth dates of all my friends. Okay, so initially my dictionary birthdays has these three key value pairs. Okay, the key value pairs are, the key is the name of the person and the value is the birth date. So Alice is April 1, Bob is December 12, and Carol is March 4, right? So this is my initial dictionary. Now I'll put this whole program into an infinite loop, and I will ask the user to enter the name of the person to retrieve the birth date of that particular person. Okay, and At the same time, I would request the user, in case if the person is not there in the dictionary, then you can add the new person in the dictionary and save the birth date of that person also. Okay, so I'll put it into a infinite while loop, which gets terminated if you hit a blank enter or a blank, you know, blank input, no input, just the enter. So that is my terminating condition. But before that, what I'll do is I'll print that enter a name, and I'll take that input and store it into the variable name. And if the name is equal to blank, right, if I directly hit enter, right, which is in fact a blank or a null value, then it will break my infinite loop, right? Now, if there is a name, that means if the person, if the user inputs a name, then what I'm going to do is I'm going to check that particular name in my dictionary birthdays, right? So I'm using the in operator here, if name in birthdays. So when it compares, after comparison, it will automatically print that this particular name is or this particular birth date is the birthday of this particular person. Okay, so for example, if I put the name as Alice, it will print that April 1 is the birth date of Alice, right? If it founds that particular name in the dictionary, this is only when the name which I enter or the name the user has entered founds in the dictionary birthdays, right? If the name is in the dictionary. But if it is not there in the dictionary, when the, let's say I enter any, some different name, let's say I enter Sanket. So if that particular name is not, that particular name is not there in my dictionary. So in that case, the program will print that I do not have birthday information for Sanket, and then print what is their birthday. So the user is now asked to input the birth date of this new person, right, which will be stored in another variable called bday. Now this will, this bday is assigned to the dictionary, our main dictionary, that is birthday's name, okay, here. And then again it will print that the birth date, the birthday database is updated. So this is actually the runtime updation of the dictionary. We are actually making changes in the dictionary or updating the dictionary in the running time. Now, once I enter that new person's detail into this dictionary, after that, when I ask to retrieve, then it will show me the output for that. But once I terminate this whole program, that updated file or the new person which I have later added, that information will no more exist, right? So after termination of the program, that data cannot be retrieved. So it's a simple program that to store an initial dictionary and ask for an input to get the information, the key value pair. But in case if the key value pair is not there in the dictionary, we are prompting the user to add that information and update the dictionary. So that is the crux of this whole program. Okay. So here is a simple demonstration of what an output would look like. Let's say the program will first say enter a name, right, and blank to quit. So if when you directly hit enter, it will automatically quit. But in case if you enter a value, if you give a value, let's say Alice, it will show me that April 1 is the birth date of Alice, right? Now purposefully what I'll do is I'll put a name which is not in the dictionary. So when the user, when the program asks me to enter a name, I give a name which is not in the dictionary. So if you can recall, Eve is not in the dictionary. Right? We have Alice, we have Bob, and we have Carol. So Eve is not in the dictionary. The user, the program will prompt me saying that I do not have birthday information for Eve. What is their birthday? And once you enter the detail or the information, this particular value is assigned to the key element E, and this key value pair is updated in the existing database, that is the existing dictionary, and it will prompt a message saying that the birthday database is updated. Now when I enter the when I enter the name Eve, it will show me the value that December 5 is the birth date of Eve, right? And next I just put enter direct blank to quit the program. Now as I mentioned, please keep it in mind that whatever this updated value, for example this Eve, December 5. This value we have updated in the dictionary in the running time of the program, right? In the compilation time or in the run time of the program. But once this whole program is terminated, when we exit this program, when we get out of this program, then this particular value pair, this particular key value pair, Eve, December 5, will no more exist in our dictionary, right? It will automatically reset to the previous initialization of our dictionary, which is this, right? So I hope the concept of dictionary is clear. Like we have discussed in our lists and tuples, the keys and the values, similarly in the dictionary also we have some methods for the keys, which is called keys method, then value method and items method. So these are the three dictionary methods. These are the methods which are only restricted to dictionary, right? And like you can clearly make it out, it will return as the values, that is the keys. The keys method will return the keys from the dictionary. The values will return only the value from the dictionary, and item will output us or return us the particular item. So in short, what these methods will return, methods will return the list like values. Now what are these list like values? We have already seen in our previous lecture, right? Important aspect to be remembered here is the dictionary method, right? The dictionary data type, it does not have the methods like amending, or the amend method what we have seen in the list, or the insert method that we have seen in the list, right? So those methods are not there in the dictionary. So let's say there is a program that there is a dictionary called spam, and we have this key value pair wherein color is red and age is 42. So if I want to print it, if I want to print this dictionary, I would do is I would simply write a simple for loop with a value calling the method values, right? So we have already discussed the format to invoke a method, that is the name of that particular dictionary, the module or the dictionary name, followed by a dot operator and the name of the method, right? So for v in spam dot values will be the proper syntax to retrieve the values, only the values of the dictionary, and when we try to print it, it will only print the values. Similarly, in the case of keys, when you put it into a for loop to output the keys, it will only retrieve the keys. So the keys here is the color and age. So it will return the color and the age. So this is the easy method to retrieve either keys or values, or both keys and values, right? So in case if you want to retrieve both keys and values, that is the time when you are going to use the method items, right? So because if you can recall, this whole thing is one item, and this whole thing is one item, like we have discussed in the lists. So you can say that a key value pair is one item. One key value pair is one item. So in case if you want to retrieve that whole item, which is nothing but the key value pair, you can simply use spam.item, right? And it will return you the key as well as the value assigned to that particular key, right? So one important aspect that you can clearly make it out here is that it is giving us output in the form of a tuple here, right? This should remind you of a tuple, right? We have in the previous class, we have understood how a tuple would look like, right? A tuple is nothing but the values inside the parentheses, right? In the list, we have square brackets, I'm repeating once again, and in the tuples, we have parentheses. So you can see here when we are making use of items, item method, the values that we are getting is in the form of tuple. So value which is returned by this method item is in the form of tuples. Now there's one more multiple assignment trick to the for loop, that in case if you want to retrieve the multiple assignment, let's say that's for the same dictionary, that is spam color red and age is 42. What we'll do is we'll assign two values, multiple values, multiple assignments, that is K, which stands for keys, and V, which stands for values. So for K comma V, in operator, please keep a note of it, we are making use of in operator, in spam dot items, right? And we are printing the keys as well as values. So printing the statement keys followed by that particular key and a value followed by that particular value, which is a converted string value, because we have an integer as well as a string here. So we are converting the integer into a string here so that we have the same data type, which is string. So when this is executed, the key, it will return that key age, and the value for the key age is 42. Similarly, the key is color and the value for color is red. So I hope the concept is clear. Anybody's so far any doubt? I've made sure that I'm touching upon the very basics, very fundamental, and explaining each and every minute detail, because these are the common syntax which you have to remember, and in case if you miss out this syntax, your program won't work, right? You will get an error. So you have to be strong, fundamentally strong in this syntax. Yeah, anybody who was having any kind of doubt before moving ahead? Okay, so let's move ahead without wasting much time. And let us move ahead to check whether a key or a particular value, a key or a particular value exists in the dictionary, right? How do we compare? A simple in operator, right? So like we have been using the in operator in the list, similarly, we have to make use of in operators in the dictionary as well. So we are simply checking whether name is in the spam dot keys or values and so on, right? So whether that particular name is there or that particular key is there in the set of keys, it will compare, it will check, right? So when the name is in the keys, you can see the name is in the key, it will return true. Sophie is in the values, then it will return true again. But color in the keys, there is no color key as well as there is no color called value in our whole dictionary. So it will return false and so on. Now, this particular statement can also be written like this. Color in spam is almost equivalent to color in spam dot keys. Right? So this is almost the same. Now you can say that the color in spam is a better version or a shorter version of color in spam dot keys. Right? Now another method, get method, which you have already come across, the get method that is used to get the values from the dictionary or get the values from the list, right? So similarly, the get method, it retrieves the value from the whole list, but the change here is the get method, it actually takes two arguments in our case, that is in the dictionary here. The two arguments are basically the key of the value to be retrieved, and also if there is no value to be retrieved, then what is the fallback value? That is also the another argument that we give to the get method. So get method actually takes two arguments. First one is the key of the value. Second is the fallback option, the fallback value. So let's say we have the dictionary called picnic items, which has apples 5 and cups 2. And I'm going to print this statement that I am bringing so-and-so cups. Now what is this so-and-so? It will compare whether the dictionary picnic item can get the value from the key cups, okay, and put it into the, convert it into the string and print in the output, right? So I am bringing dash cups. It will get the value from the dictionary. So it will basically checks whether what is the value of the cups in the dictionary. So it is 2. So we'll have the output that I am bringing 2 cups. So in case, let us say we give a value or a key, let us say we give a key to the get function or to the get method, the key which is not in the dictionary, then in that case, what is the value to be returned? In that case, it will simply say whatever the value that you have put up into the fallback argument, that will be the value which will be returned. Okay. So for example, let's say I want to print the x that will be bringing. So I will say I am bringing dash x, but we don't have x in our dictionary, right? So the fallback value for x is 0, and that therefore the output that I'll get is I am bringing 0x, because 0 is the fallback option or the fallback value or the default value, you can say, which I have assigned it for x. So this is how a simple get method looks like. Like I said, set default, as the name suggests, what it does, it sets the value default. So in case when we don't have this method, let's say we don't have this method set default, in that case, how would the code would look like is this. A simple code would look like this, that a spam is equal to this dictionary, wherein we have name as Puka and age is 5. And when we don't have a particular key in that particular dictionary, then we would be writing something like this, right? If colors not in spam, then spam colors is equal to black. So we are assigning a value to the key which is not in the dictionary, right? So this is how usually we would write our code. But since we have this default function, set default method, we can easily cut down this code and put it into a single line like this, right? This whole thing can be replaced in single line. This whole thing can be replaced with this single line, that spam dot set default colors comma black. So by default, the key color will be set to black, right? Now, again, one more important aspect to be here is, I want you to focus here, that let's say for the same dictionary, that spam color is equal to black. This is now my updated dictionary, that color is black, age is 5, and name is Puka. So this is my new dictionary. Now, I am again trying to set a default value for the key color, right? What I'm doing is I am again setting a default value, spam dot set default color comma white. So I'm setting the key color to the value white, which I have already assigned color with black, right? So in that case also, the program will give the output as black. The reason is simple, because the value for the key color is already been defined. So we are not setting any further default values, right? So when you try to output this dictionary spam, you will still get that color is black and it's not white actually. Then age is 5 and name is Puka as it is, right? So it will only consider the first value which has been set. So when we make use of, we have to consider or keep this in mind, that whenever we make use of set default method, then the first value which has been set as default, that will be considered for in case of a default value. Any further update, any further changes for that particular value will not be accepted here, right? For example, like we saw here, set default was set to black, color was set to black, which was the default. And when we try to again set default as color white, it will not take as white. Instead, it will keep the value black itself, the first value which has been assigned, right? So I hope the things are clear. Any doubts so far? Yeah, please respond. Any doubts so far? Any particular aspect that you want me to revisit? Viva says no. No, Niket says no. I don't know why few people are living in between. The strength has been down. Okay, so in case if there are no doubts, let me quickly scroll down to the participants so that I'll come to know who has left after giving attendance. When I took the attendance, it was 57 people, and now the attendance is 41. So I hope you all know that these lectures are getting recorded and your attendance will be recorded. And no doubt sufficient actions will be taken for the shortage of attendance. Okay, so I know the updated list of 40 guys who have attended. So, in case if there are no doubts further, let us move ahead and understand this whole thing with an example. So, I have a simple program here called character count, right? So character count, what will do, does it, as the name suggests, it will count the characters. Count the character in what? Count. It will count the character in whatever that I will provide to the program. So, let us say that I provide a statement to the program, a statement or a message, a meaningful message maybe to the program, and those characters in that particular statement will be counted, right? Counted by means how many number of times a particular character has been come up in that particular statement will be counted. So let's say I have a message that it was a bright cold day in April and the clock were striking 13. So this is my message or this is my string. Now the task of my program here is to compute or count every character and the number of times it has appeared. For example, let's say T. So how many times the T has been appeared? 1, 2, then 3 here, then 4 here, 5, and then 6. Probably 6 if I have not missed out anything, then it should be 6, and likewise all the other characters, right? So note that even space is a blank character. Space is also a character, right? It does have a character, I mean a value or a meaning to it, which is actually a null character, a blank character. So space is also a character and space will also be counted. And similarly all the other characters, for example special characters like a comma or a full stop will also be counted. So now this is my whole message, and the task of my program here is to calculate or compute or count every character and the number of times it has appeared in this message. Okay, so initially I will assign the count as 0 or null. This is nothing but a null value, right? Now for character in message, I'm defining a word, a variable called character in our message. Now my message is my this whole message, right? So my variable character in this whole message will be incremented every time, right? And if there is no if there is no appearance to a particular character, then the setback value or the default value that I will be setting up is 0. We have just now learned the setback method, right? What does a setback method does? It will assign a particular value in case of a default value, right? So in case if we don't encounter a particular character, it will by default set a default value of 0, right, for that particular character. So having said that, let me quickly walk you through the program. That what we'll be doing is we'll setting up a loop which will be repeatedly checking for a character in our messages, that to count the characters, and count dot set default value is 0 for that character. Okay, either the value of that character or the count of that character, or it will be 0, right? So the count of character will be incremented here in this statement. So count of character is equal to count of character plus 1. And ultimately, once the loop is exhausted, once we encounter all the characters, the print function, we will print the count stored in the variable count. Now, when we execute this, the way this count will be happening is, for example, all the uppercase letter will be calculated first and then the lowercase letter. So let me show you the output, then you can maybe able to relate the meaning what I'm trying to convey here. So this, starting from this curly brace till here, ending up or closing up my curly brace, is the my complete message, the count of the characters in my message. So these are the different messages that I have. Here is one item, separated by comma, there is another item, then this is third item, so on and so forth, right? So you can see that these comma, they are separated, they are the like the key value pair is separated by this comma here. Now note that there's one more key which is itself a comma and it has a count 1, right? Now this comma is actually from the message, which is this comma. As I said, the special characters are also characters and hence they will also be counted, like the blank character or the space, the comma, and as well as the full stop or the dot character, right? So after execution of my program, I will have this whole as the output, wherein I have this spaces, which is the single quote or opening single quote, followed by a blank space and closing single quote, which are actually 13. So if you count the number of spaces in our message, it will be 13. Number of comma, 1. Number of full stop, 1. Number of capital letter A, 1. Number of capital letter I, 1. Then number of lowercase letter A, 4, and so on. So as you can see that it is, this whole thing is ordered into a particular structured manner or in a proper ordered manner. Right. As you can see that the special characters like blank character, then comma and full stop, they are the first which are computed, then starting off with the uppercase letters, and then when we exhaust all the uppercase letters, we start with the lowercase letter in alphabetical sequence. So A, C, B, E, and so on till Y. Okay, so we don't have Z in our message, maybe that is the reason. So when we compute the value for T, let me see, T is 6. So that is what exactly we computed, right? So T is equal to 6. So I hope you got the message what I'm trying to convey here with this program, and how to make use of dictionaries, the methods which the dictionary data type allows us, right? The key method, the value method, the item method, the set default method, and so on. So these are the fundamentals and these are the syntax for these programs, for these concepts in the Python. I hope you are able to correlate what is the difference between a dictionary data type, a list data type, tuple data type, and the string data type, and so on. Right. So in case if you have any doubt so far, you can ask me. Whatever we have discussed will be there for I, and maybe another lecture, day after tomorrow's lecture, whatever we cover in day after tomorrow's lecture, that is Saturday's lecture, up till that will be there for your first time. So please revise these things, make a note of important aspects, go through it repeatedly. If you have any doubts, ask me anytime. Now, if you have any doubt so far, whatever we have covered in the today's lecture, you can ask the doubt. Please let me know if you have any doubts. Make it fast, please. Okay, so in case if there are no doubts, then we will stop the lecture here, and you are ready to, you can leave this meeting and join your next class. Okay, that concludes the lecture. Thank you.